morning and welcome to our act of worship here at St. Botolph's this morning for the second Sunday of Lent. Take just a few moments now to prepare ourselves as we come before the Lord. As we gather at the Lord's table, we must recall the promises and warnings given to us in the Scriptures, and so examine ourselves and repent of our sins. As we remember Christ's death for us and receive the pledge of his love in the Holy Communion, we must resolve to serve him in holiness and righteousness all the days of our life. Just take a few moments now to prepare our hearts and minds as we come to confess our sins. We say together, Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all people, we acknowledge and lament our many sins and the wickedness we have committed time after time, by thought, word and deed, against your divine majesty. We have provoked your righteous anger and your indignation against us. We earnestly repent and are deeply sorry for these our wrongdoings. The memory of them weighs us down. The burden of them is too great for us to bear. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that from this time forward we may always serve and please you in newness of life, to the honour and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, who in Jesus Christ has given us a kingdom that cannot be destroyed, forgive you your sins. Open your eyes to God's truth, strengthen you to do God's will, and give you the joy of his kingdom through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. The collect for today. Almighty God, you show to those who are in error the light of your truth, that they may return to the way of righteousness. Grant to all those who are admitted into the fellowship of Christ's religion, that they may reject those things that are contrary to their profession, and follow all such things as are agreeable to the same. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. So would you please be seated as we listen to our first reading.
A reading from St. Paul's letter, first letter to the Romans, chapter 4, beginning at verse 13. The promise that Abraham would inherit the world did not come to Abraham or to his descendants through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. If it is the adherents of the law who are to be the heirs, faith is null and the promise is void. For the law brings wrath, but where there is no law, neither is there violation. For this reason, it depends on faith, in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his descendants, not only to the adherents of the law, but also to those who share the faith of Abraham. For he is the father of all of us, as it is written, I have made you the father of many nations. Abraham believed in the presence of the God who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist. Hoping against hope, he believed that he would become the father of many nations, according to what was said, "So numerous shall your descendants be." He did not weaken in faith when he considered his own body, which was already as good as dead, for he was about 100 years old, or when he considered the barrenness of Sarah's womb. No distrust made him waver concerning the promise of God, but he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God, being fully convinced that God was able to do what he had promised. Therefore, his faith was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now the words, "it was reckoned to him," were written not for his sake alone, but for ours also. It will be reckoned to us who believe in God, who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead, who was handed over to death for our trespasses, and was raised for our justification. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Be please stand for the gospel reading, if you are able to stand. Praise to you, O Christ, King of eternal glory. The Lord is a great God, for that today you will listen to his voice. Harden not your hearts. Praise to you, O Christ, King of eternal glory. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus began to teach his disciple that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all this quite openly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciple and said to them, "If anyone wants to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
May I speak in the name of the living God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Would you please be seated? Jesus says to us, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it." Yes, those are words that Jesus says to us today. They're not just words that were spoken over 2,000 years ago and recorded in a book, but they are words that we need to hear today. And they're ones that we may be familiar with, but do we understand them enough to know what to do with them? As we worship this morning, we are aware that through Lent, we are moving towards that Holy Week, which will come very soon and ends with Christ on the cross. What does that Holy Week mean to us as followers of Christ, as his disciples today in the 21st century? Well, today's reading is very appropriate, a very appropriate reading for Lent 2021, as it reminds us that Christ is throwing down the gauntlet and setting us a challenge to face. He is encouraging us to take up our cross, but he's also saying, if you're ready to accept the invitation to be my disciple, then you must also be willing to follow me. They're challenging words, which at first glance, it may seem, will give us an easy choice to make. But when it's stripped bare and laid bare, is it really as simple as it seems? Jesus says, take up your cross. In other words, pick it up yourself. Be prepared. This means we have a choice to make. Christ himself had a choice as to whether he was going to pick up his cross. He could have said no, but he didn't, and he bore his cross to Golgotha. And while it is incredibly unlikely that if we bear our cross, then we will face death, we still have a choice whether to accept his invitation and pick ours up and bear it, or to walk away. Bearing our cross. It's a voluntary form of sacrificial obedience that identifies us completely with Jesus Christ. Bearing our cross is not about making the best of a situation or circumstance. It's something we deliberately choose to take up and risk the consequences. But that's an uncomfortable idea for most of us. So what does bearing our cross mean to each one of us today? Well, no doubt we'll all have our own view. But for me, it reminds me of one of my favourite poems by Robert Frost. You may know the words well. Two roads diverged in a yellow wood, and sorry I could not travel both and be one traveller. Long I stood, and looked down one as far as I could, to see where it bent in the undergrowth, then took the other, as just as fair, and having perhaps the better claim, because it was grassy and wanted wear. Though as for that, the passing there had worn them really about the same. And both that morning equally lay in leaves no step had trodden back. Oh, I kept the first for another day. Yet knowing how way leads on to way, I doubted if I should ever come back. I shall be telling this with a sigh somewhere ages and ages hence. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less travelled by, and that has made all the difference. When we take up our cross, we step out into the unknown, the less travelled road, as it were. It can be much more difficult because we don't know what could be there around the next corner. But as much as it can fill us with trepidation, it can also fill us with joy and happiness and optimism as we experience what it has to offer. It's up to each of us how we approach it, whether it is with fear or eager anticipation. And Christ is certainly speaking about this kind of choice today. He is laying out what is going to happen during his ministry and preparing those listening for the parts which they are going to find difficult, the suffering, the rejection, and ultimately his death on the cross. But he also alludes to the resurrection and the joy that that will bring. No one at that point in what is now our history had the benefit of hindsight. They were not reliving the events, they were actually living them firsthand, experiencing everything for the first time and making choices from their gut and doing the best that they could. Whereas we are in a more privileged position. We know what happened because we can read their accounts. But even with this information, this knowledge, it can only take us so far, because the rest of the road asks us to take a step of faith, to follow where he wants to lead, without us knowing how our future is going to unfold. This is what being a Christian, a disciple, means. Allowing Christ into our lives in a way that we don't yet know, and allowing him to be our guide. Taking up our cross and following him is about trust and the obedience of giving oneself and knowing that wherever he leads will be a place of love and grace as we enter into deeper relationship with our Saviour. The cross is the principal symbol of Christianity, and we say this at every baptism we perform as we make the sign of the cross on the forehead of the newly baptized. This symbol holds special meaning for every one of us who identify with Christ Jesus. Whenever we see a cross, it speaks to us of Christ's resolute determination to do his Father's will by dying for us. Taking up our cross is about each of us making a deliberate and personal choice. It's about discipline, hard work, obedience and commitment. It isn't easy, but it draws us closer to Christ and hopefully makes us more Christ-like. Never has a symbol of such pain and torture been transformed into a symbol of unending love and hope, which is recognised the world over as the cross which Christians recognise and bear. When we come to the point in our lives where each one of us can say, I am making a wholehearted commitment to God in my life, then prayer and reading our Bible will become a central part of our daily lives. And we will want to worship him and bow down before him. We will search the scriptures to know more of the will of God and the welcome we have for others in and outside church will be intensified, and our love for others will be evident in all our actions. If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me, says Jesus. So we have the choice, one which can change our lives in ways that we will never know. We cannot know. So dare we follow him? Dare we follow the way of the cross?
Amen. So I invite you now to stand with me and affirm our faith together in the words of the Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory, to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Could I invite you please to sit or kneel for our prayers of intercession.
Let us pray, thanking God for his loving faithfulness and bringing to him our own concerns and the needs of the world around us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving God, as you revealed yourself to Abraham centuries ago, reveal yourself to us in this present time. Make us a trusting, faithful people, ready to believe your promises, willing to follow you wherever you lead. During this period of Lent, give us a new awareness of your presence and teach us the humility to accept that all our gifts come from you to be used in the service of your people. Live in us through all our small acts of sacrifice and help us to be cheerful in our fasting and giving, as our Lord Jesus Christ commanded. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving God, we pray for your church worldwide, asking that all who believe in you may be strengthened to remain faithful to their calling. We pray for the witness of the Church, particularly in places where the Christian faith is forgotten, ignored, or unknown. We pray for those who carry responsibilities as leaders, our archbishops, bishops, ministers, those who are always expected to know what to say and do, whatever the situation. Give them compassion, wisdom, and the mind of Christ. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving God, we rejoice in the beauty of this world, especially as we see the signs of new life as spring begins. We wonder joyfully at the diversity, complexity, and beauty of your creation. But we pray for the countless numbers of your children who suffer in this world because of violence, oppression, injustice, and the effects of the global pandemic. We remember all those who lack homes, food, clean water, or medical supplies. We pray for ourselves that we may see more clearly the needs of these, your children, and that we may respond appropriately, for they are our brothers and sisters. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving God, we hold before you all those in authority. We give thanks for the steadfast service of our Queen during her long reign. We pray for her and for the health of the Duke of Edinburgh. We pray that those who govern should dedicate themselves to the common good, and ask that in the heat of conflicting convictions, you would keep them in integrity and truth. We pray for our own government, faced with difficult decisions to make over the coming months. We pray for those involved in the world of education, all those preparing to welcome children back to schools in a safe manner. And we give thanks for the unwavering dedication and commitment of teachers throughout this past difficult year. We continue to give you thanks for all those working in the medical profession, for scientists, and for all who have been involved in the creation and administration of COVID vaccinations. We long and pray for healing physically, mentally, and spiritually, for this and for every nation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving God, we pray for those whom we love, the special people you have given to us to enrich our lives. We pray for our friends, the close ones and the ones we sometimes forget, those with special problems, those who need you. We give thanks for each of them and rejoice in what they give to us. Keep us as faithful to them as you are to us. Give grace to us, our families and friends, and to all our neighbours, that we may serve our Lord in one another and love as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving God, we pray for all those for whom today will be difficult, for the lonely, the sick and suffering, those awaiting news and test results. We pray for those living with desperation and hopelessness. Send the comfort of your Spirit on all who struggle and fear, and on all those who mourn. Meet us all in our times of questioning, anger, and doubt. Show us what we can do to enable one another to overcome isolation, distress, and despair, and make us a humbler people who recognise our need of you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving God, we remember with gratitude all those we have loved and who have left their mark on our lives by giving us love and laughter, but who have now gone before us to be with you. We pray especially today for the soul of Captain Sir Tom Moore, whose courage, hope, and kindness was a light in a time of great darkness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving and faithful God, as we go out into the world today, help us to set our minds on divine things and not human ones. May we not be ashamed to witness to you, nor be afraid of taking up our cross to follow you. Help us to remember that your Son was tempted, but chose faithfulness before popularity, service before fame, and sacrifice before power. Give us the strength to reject temptation throughout our Lenten journey and beyond it throughout the rest of our lives. Rejoicing in St. Botolph and all the saints, we commend ourselves and all faithful people to your unfailing love. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
If you are able, would you please stand as we share the peace? Since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given us access to his grace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of peace. Jesus, true vine and bread of life, ever giving yourself that the world might live, let us share your death and passion. Make us perfect in your love. Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right and good to give you thanks and praise, Almighty God and Everlasting Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son. For in these 40 days you lead us into the desert of repentance, that through a pilgrimage of prayer and discipline we may grow in grace and learn to be your people once again. Through fasting, prayer and acts of service, you bring us back to your generous heart. Through study of your holy word, you open our eyes to your presence in the world and free our hands to welcome others into the radiant splendour of your love. As we prepare to celebrate the Easter feast with joyful hearts and minds, we bless you for your mercy and join with saints and angels forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We praise and bless you, loving Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord. As we obey his command, send your Holy Spirit, that broken bread and wine outpoured may be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. On the night before he died, he had supper with his friends, and taking bread, he praised you. He broke the bread, gave it to them, and said, Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When supper was ended, he took the cup of wine. Again he praised you, gave it to them and said, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross. Bringing before you the bread of life and the cup of salvation, we proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, Lord Jesus, until you come in glory. Lord of all life, help us to work together for that day when your kingdom comes and justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favour on your people, gather us in your loving arms and bring us with the Blessed Virgin Mary, St. Botolph and all the saints to feast at your table in heaven. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours, O loving Father, for ever and ever. Amen. Amen. Please sit or kneel. Trusting in the compassion of God, our Saviour, as our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Jesus, Lamb of God, have mercy on us. Jesus, bearer of our sins, have mercy on us. Jesus, Redeemer of the world, grant us peace. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. Let us pray. Almighty God, you see that we have no power of ourselves to help ourselves. Keep us both outwardly in our bodies and inwardly in our souls, that we may be defended from all adversities which may happen to the body, and from all evil thoughts which may assault and hurt the soul. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. We'll say together, Father of all, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace, and opened the gate of glory. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We whom the Spirit lights, give light to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. For those of you who are watching this service, and don't yet receive our emails which we send out daily, if you'd like to receive them, then please do get in touch with us and we can happily add you to the distribution list. Our emails contain lots of information about things happening here in the church family, in the parish, and in the wider world. And obviously, the more people we can communicate with, the better. The work that we have
authorised to happen in the church that the PCC have agreed and instructed contractors to start is now beginning, and Jeff Sayers, who is leading the group for our project, will be giving an update every week with photographs so that you can keep abreast of what is actually going on in the church building. You are all in our prayers, and if there is anything that you have any concerns over that you would like prayer for, or if you would like to speak to someone, then please do get in touch. We'd be happy to speak with you. And the blessing. Christ, give you grace to grow in holiness, to deny yourselves, take up your cross and follow him. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.